Thank you all very much for coming. I'm Michael Green, Senior Vice President for Asia and Japan Chair at CSIS. It's a bittersweet day. In a few days, Ambassador Fujisaki, after distinguished service here in Washington, is going home. But it's also an opportunity for us to pick his brain before he leaves Washington. We will shortly invite the Ambassador and Dr. John Hamry, the President and CEO of CSIS, to the stage for a discussion. Before that, Ambassador Fujisaki is going to give a presentation. Then the dialogue on stage between Dr. Hamry and the Ambassador, and then I'll come up and help direct your questions and answers. So thank you very much for joining us. Ichiro Fujisaki served here in Washington in different capacities. He was political minister at the embassy from 95 to 99, but he really has been an honorary American since the early 1960s, during which time he was a junior high school student in Seattle, Washington. And he also studied at Brown for a year and at Stanford for a year in the early 1970s. As a diplomat, Fujisaki-san has also served in Jakarta and Paris as the ambassador to the OECD and in London. And he was the ambassador to the UN and to the WTO in Geneva before coming to Washington. And in Geneva, he also served as chairman of the executive committee of the UN High Commission on Refugees. He's had key posts in the foreign ministry in Tokyo, where many of us have had the privilege of working with him, director general for Asian Affairs, director general for North American Affairs, deputy foreign minister, and that role is Sherpa for the G8 and other multilateral meetings. His wife, Yoriko, who many of you know, is a virtual Washingtonian. She went to kindergarten here. Their daughters attended school in Washington, Stone Ridge, and Somerset Elementary School, which is the rival to my elementary school, Chevy Chase Elementary School. I won't sing our fight song because it was 100 years ago and I don't remember it. Fujisaki-san also has done interesting research at IISS in London, at Sophia University, and so forth. And yesterday, in a rare and very high honor, Ambassador Fujisaki was awarded the Distinguished Public Service Medal by the Secretary of the Navy, which is the highest, as I understand it, the highest award that can be given to a civilian. So it's quite a distinction. So congratulations, Ambassador, and welcome, and we look forward to your remarks. Thank you.
I was a little dizzy, but I heard that Mike saying that he's going to kick my brain. No, thank you very much for being here. Maybe you're here because you're tired of being in front of television now and you want something change. But congratulations for the election result yesterday. I think this shows the strength of the United States. Today, I just wanted to talk about something little what I've been thinking for some time. If we come to think of it, in the 20th century, there were epoch-making years, like 1917, 1939, 1945, 1989. We have just entered 21st century. So it may be a little too early, but I think 2011 can be remembered as a historical year in this century because of three reasons. Because these things people were not expecting, and this will linger on for years. One is the stability of regional integration. Second is Arab Spring. And third, nuclear power. All these were not expected to come in 2011, and now we'll have to face the problem. I'll start from regional integration. European Union has been source of stability. like to congratulate that they have received Nobel Prize. However, it is true that Europe is becoming little of concern to the rest of the world. If we think of why, because single currency that European Union has introduced made look a country stronger than sometimes what it is for some weak economies. And they were able to borrow money in a very favorable interest rate. Then they accumulated debt as well. And because of single currency, it would deprive the adjustment capability of the currency. And the deficit, current account deficit, has increased. The only way now is that strong economies in the European Union should help those weak economies. And they are now trying to do that, but that's awfully difficult, unpopular in the stronger economies. So they are now struggling through. We hope that the European Union will come out of this, but we know that all that this is not a cyclical issue. It's a structural issue. Come to think of it, European Union started from Benelux, Belgium, Netherlands, Luxembourg, three countries who wanted to compete with other countries. When GATT was introduced in 1948, two groups of countries wanted some exception. One was this Benelux. They thought they can't compete with Germany or France because they are small countries. So they said, we have to make customs union. The other one was Lebanon and Syria wanted something like free trade area negotiation. The difference is that customs union, you have a common custom free amongst your countries and common customs towards other countries. Free trade area, you can have different customs rate against other countries. So this is the difference between two. But free trade, Lebanon and Syria's free trade area negotiations remain somewhat small for years. But then both of them grew very rapidly in the 90s. Now we have EU27. And after NAFTA was developed in 1990s, now we have more than 300 FTAs. So the small hole which people made for GATT as an exception for small countries have now become very big. And I'm saying that FTA is good for promoting trade. We have a lot of FTAs now after 2000, year 2000. And we are thinking of developing FTA in Asia Pacific as well. But we have to think that these are exceptions to most favored nation treaty of GATT. It can't be the rule. Why? Because smaller countries are not in it. Emerging countries are often invited in. My Green just said that I was in Seattle Junior High School. That was 50 years ago. I remember very fondly those days. But there are not that fond time there as well. I'll be very frank. There was dance in gymnasium. And in that dance class, boys were gathered in the center and girls surrounded them. And girls could choose the boys to dance. And then vice versa, boys would go out and the girls would be chosen. It's thrilling, but what a scary time for a 12-year boy if you are going to be left out. And I can see that now some countries are asked to dance or to get into these free trade area agreements. Some countries are left out. And some of the smaller countries, least developing countries, I think are waiting for chances. And if the country, if the world, there are imbalances, that could not go on too long. Now, I think we have to go back and revive strong, make it WTO again strong. I'm not saying that we should revive Doha round per se, because it's not possible. We have tried so many times. I think we have to do several things. One is to agree on standstill, not to go back formally in WTO, what we have already committed. Second, we have an agreement called single undertaking. That is that everything agriculture, industry, service have to do at once. And that has been sort of binding us. And it's so difficult to make all agreement at once. So I think we should start looking at some things we can do one by one. Third, strengthen the secretariat so that if someone country makes concession, that is noted, recorded in the secretariat, so that people think that they don't have to hold on to card all the way. Sometimes they can display what they have already. It hasn't happened at all because it's so difficult to evaluate. I know the technical difficulty, but that's fourth is make a good small group. GATT is consisted of more than 150 countries, and surprisingly, it's not voting, it's consensus. Everyone has to agree. And if the economic interest is so difficult, it's so difficult to get 150 countries to agree at once. So I think there should be balanced about 10 countries or so from LDC as well, least developed country, and some of the big trading companies, and make a group and discuss. Sometimes maybe changes, but that kind of thing, not 20 or 30, but the smaller countries should be considered as well, balanced. Lastly, we have not really done good work in export side, or for example, minerals, energy resources. We have not really regulated those, and some countries have used those when they have more minerals or rare earth or whatever. So we have to have more regulation rules on that. I think these are the things I think we have to watch. These are all my thinking as a person and private, and it's not representing Japanese government, but this is what I think on trade issues. Second big thing that is, as I said, Arab Spring. It is to be welcomed. That has happened, and that's the people's choice. We have to help them. But now, we should remember that for some time, there were leaders who tried to be in between so-called the West and Arab public, the Muslim world. And now these people, many of the people are gone. We have to face this Muslim world straight. And after Arab Spring, at that time, there were euphoria, but that is quickly evaporating. For example, in Egypt, tourism is a very important industry. From 2010 to 2011, because of Arab Spring as well, the tourism has dropped 33%. Unemployment from 2010 to 2011, 2010 was 9.1%. 2011 was 12.1%. 2012 is deemed to be 12.7%. There's a lot of frustration when the heat is over. So we have to address this situation. I think three ways. One, we have to revive Middle East peace process, really. And Middle East peace process, when it really moved, was when United States, at the highest level, took the lead. Second, we have to continue to impose sanction on Iran, and so that Iran would come around for real dialogue, and maybe real dialogue they have to do with the United States. Third, because they are facing economic difficulties, we have to really help Middle East countries economically. As for Afghan, Pakistan, Iraq, Palestinian, three countries in one area, U.S. has been the number one country for giving contributions, economic for reconstruction. Japan has been number two in all three countries and one area, Afghan, Iraq, Pakistan, and Palestinian. I think these efforts, not only by Japan and the United States, but others, should continue to be fortified. Third thing that has happened in 2011 that would continue on is this nuclear issue. 3/11 was a big disaster. Earthquake, tsunami, nuclear accident happened at the same time. Never mankind has experienced that at the same time. We are now coming back. But we were not able to do that without help of people around the world. Top of the list were Americans. American soldiers, American government, American companies, American schools, American people, American kids. They all come to help us. So this was most unlucky incident, but we were lucky to have Americans as our partner. So representing all Japanese, I always say, thank you very much. Arigatou gozaimasu. I said that we are coming back. Did I say anything wrong? No. However, one big issue still we have to be facing is this nuclear power generation. We had 54 nuclear reactors, number three in the world. US has 104, France has 57, Japan had 54. But in the last 30 years, US made zero after 3 miles. Japan made 29. We were number one in that sense. So we were trying to help. We had to have a big companies like Mitsubishi, Hitachi, Toshiba, cooperating with American companies. And they are still. But in earthquake tsunami, 14 out of 54 were affected. So 40 were intact. But every 13 months, we have to put the reactor into maintenance. So, as of May 5th, this year, nuclear power generation became zero. And Prime Minister, with the consent of the local community, started two reactors. And out of all this 54, 40 were intact, and only two are operating now. It was a very different from Chernobyl. Chernobyl, there was no container vessel and killed more than 30 people immediately. There were no immediate death toll in Fukushima. So all the radioactive material discharge was 1/7 of that of Chernobyl. However, like what has happened in 3 miles, people got very concerned. And that's not only in Japan. Germany said they will withdraw from nuclear. France said, President Hollande said they'll decrease from 75 to 50%. Swiss said they will depart from nuclear power generation. And Italy, they don't have it, but they said they are not going to do it. Japan, about 30% people think that we should abolish nuclear. 40% on top of that people think we should decrease it. Only in 2010, we were saying that we have about 26% of our electricity generated by nuclear, and we will double it to about 50% by 2030. Now government is saying, this is not a cabinet decision, but some of the committees and the government is saying that we will put all the effort to try to attain nuclear zero in 2030s. It's a totally different direction. We have not made, as I said, any decision, and we'll constantly review our decisions, how to go wrong with this. And business community in Japan are very careful about, because we need electricity, energy. So there are problems we have to be facing. Can we get enough energy? Could we be competitive? Can we have really have an environmental, we were number one energy efficient economy, but can we continue to be an ecological country? And one of the issues that we have to be thinking is that now the nuclear power generator exporting countries are Republic of Korea, Russia, and maybe Japan and potentially China. If Japan and France is decreasing the dependency, we will leave it to others. And how is that in US global political scene? That not only economic, but that has to be considered as well, I think. These are some of the issues, I think, that has emerged from 2011, which we have to be thinking in the years to come. How do we do with world economy? How do we do with Middle East situation? How do we do with this nuclear? All that concerns United States and Japan. I think, and I will just touch upon two things. One is that several years ago, we have said that now G20 became the prime organization to discuss trade and economic issues. There are G7 and G8 as well. And I personally think that smaller number of countries discussing like-minded how to move world economy, trade issues, and terrorism, nuclear proliferation was important. I was a Sherpa, and I thought that was a very rare meeting where leaders would not read out of paper. There were only 8 or 9 leaders in the room, and we were surrounding them as note takers, and that was all, less than 20 people in one room, and there are not too many occasions like that. I think that we have to use more of those smaller meetings. US and Japan, I think, has gone a lot of phases in the last few years. I'm quite hopeful about US-Japan relations. I've been always saying that it doesn't sound too Japanese, maybe a little Chinese, but there are three no's. One is that, no surprise, allies like Japan and the United States should always be careful not to surprise each other. As for Christmas gifts, there could be a happy surprise, birthdays. not in between countries. We have to inform each other very well. And I think we have a good mechanism for that. Second is no over-politicization. Some issues could be dealt discreetly. And always we have to keep in mind, try to do that as discreet as possible. It doesn't mean that we should not be transparent. We should be transparent, but we should not try to make big issues out of it. Third is no take for granted. Japan and US is married over 60 years. I've been married only for, 35 years, but still. My wife thinks everything is done by her, and I think I'm doing a lot more than she does. And in reality, I think in order to manage alliance well, we have to recognize what others are doing. For example, we have this now islands issue in South China, East China Sea, Senkaku Island issue. The fact that we have U.S. security, Japan-U.S. security arrangement, and that the arrangement covers these islands is a great deterrence. We have to recognize that, and we are grateful for that to the United States, that they have repeatedly said that this is covered. Secretary Clinton, Secretary Panetta. At the same time, U.S. forces are in Japan, concentrated in Okinawa. We have to improve the situation, and we are discussing that. Some people said U.S. forces or presence is like oxygen. I do not take that view. Oxygen, yes, indispensable, but oxygen, you don't smell it. You don't see it. U.S. forces are there to be seen. You have to exercise. But that brings some burden to the surrounding people, and there are incidents as well. You should not think that this is oxygen. And we have to be very concerned, sensitive to any of those things arising. And I'm very cognizant that the U.S. government, U.S. military, is thinking in that way. So these are the how to manage U.S. Japan. This is my last opportunity to be here in Washington. I'll be flying out in 3 days' time. So I'm very grateful to Dr. Hamry and Dr. Green for giving me this opportunity to express my thinking. This is, again, my personal thinking, not necessarily present Japanese government's view. But again, thank you very much for being here. And I am thanking Dr. Hamry, Dr. Mike Green, and all of you. And I think if I thank this much, I may not get tough questions. I thank you very much.
Thank you. Wasn't that interesting?
Oh, a little too loud.
That was very interesting, and rarely do we have a chance to engage a very senior diplomat. You've shared with us your perspective on some substance. I would like to just spend a little time learning about your profession and to talk about diplomacy in the in the modern era, if I may. You've touched on some of this, but I'd like to explore it a little bit more. So,
I feel like commencement examination.
It's a little bit like that, but I'm an easy grader. I want you to know. Let me just start. I mean, you mentioned during your comments that you had experience as a Sherpa, and that you've worked in informal international structures, but I also know that you've been in formal international structures. You were at Geneva, for example. And there are two kinds of internationalism when you think about it. You have formal structural internationalism, where you embed it in a treaty and you create an institution and you participate in it. And then you have informal internationalism, like G7s, G20s, coalitions of the willing, this sort of thing. You know, the benefit of formal internationalism is that it's normative. You know, if you set up an institution, you train the next generation on how to deal with problems. But they become brittle. Informal internationalism is very dynamic, and you get a lot done, but it isn't normative. So how do you as a diplomat think about these different tools as you try to accomplish the goals for your country?
I personally think that there's not that much distinction between the two, because in the formal one, as you have said, there are three things that would accompany those formal meetings. That is the agenda setting, you have to do this and that by that. Second is the side meeting on those ministerial or whatever meetings. There'll be a lot of side meetings, and that's a very valuable meeting. And related to agenda setting, but you have a lot of informal meetings, preparation meetings run up to the formal, and that's not that different from smaller meetings which you have. So I think it's not that easy to assume. But I personally feel that in some cases there's a good size meeting where you have to really discuss issues without reading out from notes. And a lot of people of our age, if I may say, you are younger than
I'm me. Much older. I didn't keep
but,
as well.
We'll speak a lot, but we don't want to listen to people that much. Thank you very much for listening, but they don't want to take notes. They want to speak out. So if I have to go to a meeting and I have to listen to someone read out speech for 2 hours, 3 hours, I think this is so difficult. And so some of the meetings you see that someone's speaking, but only few people are there in the room, only their delegation or something like that. So I think from that, I think there's some merit in both formal meetings and informal meetings, but it's little sort of a mixed and not too easy to distinguish.
But let me, I'm not trying to be disputatious, you know, it isn't that. But let me press a little bit here because
I was afraid of that.
But you know, when you have a formal structural internationalism, like at the UN, things become brittle over time. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, just last week or the week before, they decided who was going to be on the Security Council, and they picked Luxembourg over Finland. Well, that doesn't make any sense. I mean, you know, with all due respect, I mean, but yet that's part of how these structures adapt. And that's why, in some sense, formal internationalism is less effective, because it gets caught in its own process. And yet, Japan has been one of the foremost leaders of working in the international system. So how do you feel about it? I mean, Japan should be in the Security Council. It should be a permanent member of the Security Council.
Thank you very
much. And yet
much,
we
sir.
Don't have this. I mean, so how do we balance this?
I was waiting for you to say thank you very much. As for Security Council, I think we should be in it too. It's because of two reasons. Our contribution is second in the world, mm-hmm. and our contribution is more than UK, Russia, China added, or France, Russia, China added. So I'm not saying no tax without no representation, but there are those things as well. Second thing important is that we are non-nuclear weapon country. We have to show to the world that you don't have to become mm-hmm. nuclear power country, weapon country, to become to be in driving seat of the world. We have not taken that course for 50 years, and I think those should be recognized. But I'm sorry, I'm not answering your question right away, but I think there should be effort on the international community to change. It's difficult once structure is made, but try to continue to change these constitutions.
Let me shift just to ask about your concept about an ambassador. When you first started, when you first entered the Foreign Service, you know, back then, you know, it would take you days to get to a new country, and that we had aviation, but it still was taking days. Your father's generation, you took a boat, it would take weeks. Back when you probably first started, you had telexes and maybe telephones, but it wasn't this instantaneous, globe-spanning technology. So a diplomat 50 years ago really was the embodiment of a country, but with some detachment. Now we're in an era where, you know, a minister can fly over here in 14 hours and frequently does. They can pick up the phone and frequently call. What's the role of an ambassador in an era when communication is instantaneous?
I'm not representing all the ambassadors, but I think when I read Harold Nicholson's Diplomacy, which was written before the war, I think, it said that already in 1920s or so, because we have this cable, diplomats' role has diminished. And nearly 100 years have passed. Mm. And always we've been saying that, but we have big embassies. Our embassy, your embassy in Tokyo, is several times bigger than ours. But the reason, I think, is that we have to be constantly in touch. I think that's one of the most important. I have about 100 people from Tokyo. They are going around and meeting people, the Congress, defense, state, finance, and all, and the meeting private think tanks and business people too. And then they can sort of get what's important in this town. If you're only in your capital, so what I always think that we have to be doing is to tell Tokyo, my capital, what we have to be doing. Maybe we have to be doing this, and those recommendations we make from here by meeting everyone, this may become important. For example, I have told Tokyo that after earthquake, debris in the Pacific may become a big issue. We have to do something beforehand. And Tokyo was thinking the same way. So Prime Minister Noda pledged $5 million to Secretary Clinton in Vladivostok just 2 months ago. And these things you can catch when you are here, as you are consulate in Seattle, in Washington, what's becoming important.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. If I could also, just in my very simple-minded way, say there's a difference between information and knowledge. You can get information through the internet. You can't get knowledge. You know, you really have to have judgment and perspective.
I think,
and
as you
wisdom.
Say, it's a prioritization. You can't do everything, so you have to prioritize, that's the sense of what has to be done first. Mm-hmm. And it may be a little presumptuous for a diplomat to say, but I've been saying that for diplomats, what's the characters needed is like a newspaper reporter. You have to be sensitive to information. Like academic, you have to analyze the situation. Third, like politicians, you have to be a good communicator and make decisions. forth, you have to be like a lawyer to negotiate the details. And lastly, you have to be, it's a little difficult to say, but you have to be a social figure, communicating with people, cultural issues, and all these. You can't be A plus in all five, but you can't get D or C in three or so. You have to be B or C, B minus average, or something like that.
But they only pay you for one of those five jobs, don't they? let me, Ambassador, you referred in, you talk about the three crises and the crises of economic integration in Europe. We have, you know, it's interesting, I'd ask you to reflect on the different ways that Europe and Asia have thought to coordinate international phenomena. You know, I mean, all the problems in the world, the complex problems in the world, are all horizontal, and the governments are all vertical. You know, and so this is one of the problems. How do we solve this problem when we have to work with others, and there aren't real, you know, we have to develop structures. Now, in Europe, they decided to dissolve their political sovereignty in order to protect their economic well-being. In Asia, they've decided to dissolve their economic sovereignty, becoming globally competitive, in order to protect their political sovereignty. How does Asia address this question of developing structures for international cooperation in Asia? Where do you think this goes?
I think eventually there could be several courses, but for the moment, I think Asian situation has not arrived to where Europe is. Europe, still you have a common, in many cases, religion and common culture, and the country size is not that different. Some are small countries, but here in Asia, they are huge countries, very small countries. Economic development is very different from countries to countries. So I think for the moment, we will try to have something like ASEAN Plus 3, APEC, FTAA, and those economic fora with some political touch of EAS or not becoming something a very integrated in the long run, that's possibility, but for the moment I think we would have to start from economic and see where we can. I think the issues that are arising in Asia Pacific shows that that's more realistic.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask you to reflect on TPP in this light? How do you see that fitting in this?
I think TPP is a very useful tool for all free trade area of Asia Pacific. We have many FTAs. We have FTA with ASEAN. We are contemplating of FTA with China, Korea. And there's a TPP as well, so these all could be pillars to try to arrive to FTA, the whole free trade area of Asian Pacific. Now for Japan, we have not decided to go into negotiations. We are now consulting with the United States and other countries, and we hope that this process will be accelerated as well, I think. Both sides have to do some work. I think Japan has to be thinking of how we should can accelerate it. U.S. May have to be thinking how, if they want Japan to have them without too much putting conditions.
Mm-hmm. Ambassador, during much of your time in office, Japan has worked to find an active diplomacy that was consistent with a constitution that was imposed on you by the United States that, you know, limited your military and, you know, things of this nature. I have a sense that Japan is debating this, that there's an internal debate going on over, you know, how should this change? Should there be the kind of code words, collaborative defense and things like this? But where do you think this is going to go over the next 10 years? I mean, to what degree do you think there'll be either a constitutional change or a new consensus of interpretation that broadens the base of Japan's power base in Asia?
I think first we have to identify what is lacking, what we have to do, and if that needs a legal or constitutional change. And that is what people in Japan has to decide. But rather than just discussing that, are we going to make a legal change or constitutional, whatever, I think first, what do we want to do? What do we have to do and we're not able to do has to be clearly identified.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And do you think that there's a consensus on that at this point in Japan?
I don't think so. Mm-hmm. I don't think so.
Don't think so. And what do you think would be the mechanism by which a new consciousness would emerge?
I think the political situation within and surrounding Japan may lead Japan to thinking about more about other forms of diplomacy. Security. But for the moment, I think Japan has been saying, Japanese has been in the poll saying that 70% of Japanese, I think, are saying that they're comfortable with the present form of security, that is nuclear deterrence or deterrence by United States and self-defense force together. And maybe there could be other forms as well, but it is not the majority of Japan's thinking that we would go autonomous without US or join others for security. That I think the keeping present form and maybe modify something, but if that modification needs legal requirement or not is the issue.
And a collective defense would be kind of just an extension of this consciousness. You would see that?
I think so, yes.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
If we need change in those concepts or not, first we have to identify the situation.
Mm-hmm. Forgive me, I was given the privilege of a few minutes here, and then I'm going to turn to Mike Green to engage all of you in this conversation. Can I return now to the point you discussed at the very end, and that's nuclear, the future of the energy policy of Japan. Of course, this is, we understand the understandable anxiety that Japanese citizens feel about the tragedy at Fukushima. But we also look at a country that, you were blessed with talented people and lovely landscape, but not a lot of energy. And nuclear power gave you a capacity for reliable base energy generation. What do you think now should be done to help develop a new consensus in Japan about a long-term energy strategy, not just kind of a, well, maybe now, but not now, and we'll keep flexibility. I mean, right now it's kind of a treading water. Mm-hmm. What would it take to develop a long-term strategy?
Exactly. I think we have just had, only a year and a half ago, this huge nuclear accident. And it takes time to review all the mechanism. And we have just established new regulatory commission for nuclear. And they will come up with a new criteria by next summer. And we will check all the nuclear power generators with this new criteria established by a new commission. Very frankly, what has existed had lost confidence of people for some time. So we have had to create very new structure. I hope that this new structure will produce the criteria that would give confidence to people.
Thank you very much. Mike, can I ask you to come up and then lead the conversation with the rest of our audience here today? Thank you all very much for listening to this.
Thank you. Doctor, thank you. Your graduation exam is not over yet. but you'll be able to go home. I'm sure you'll pass. So we want to open it up to the audience. I think we have some microphones. And I will call on you, and please identify yourself. Questions are encouraged. Speeches are discouraged.
No, you can make a 10-minute speech.
hypothetical questions, you can try, but... So, up here in the front, Taylor.
Ambassador, this is Deborah Kayatani from Democracy Work. I'm a consultant on homeland security issues. I was wondering if you would comment on your view of the so-called grassroots leadership of Japan, the younger generation, what you see and what you would expect prepare for, I suppose. How you feel about the response to the nuclear accident, for example, and their capacity to provide diplomatic communications and answers when working with United States, especially United States news agencies.
I don't know if I'm correct answering you straightforwardly, but a lot of Japanese media were saying that Japanese youngsters are so inward looking and not really coming out to foreign countries or up to volunteerism. But as you say, after 3/11, a lot of volunteers, the young people came out, and I was very encouraged about that. Now, as for internationalization of these young people, I think that compared to Chinese or Korean friends, many of the Japanese people do not come out to United States. The overall young people going out of United States are going out of Japan are not decreasing, but to United States, UK, it's decreasing. And I think I am encouraging two things. One is to CEOs of big companies, please make a quota, set a quota for foreign college graduates to join your company. Second thing is that we have to improve English education. After 8 years of English education, not too many of Japanese can speak English. And I think we have to improve that. And for that, I think I've been promoting an idea that Japanese national English language teachers should be sent to United States and spend a year or so. And when they go back, she or he'll be teaching a class of 35 classes, and in 30 years they'll be teaching 5,000 students each. And what a great investment. So I was able to talk to Prime Minister, and we have started from last year, this new project. And it's not a huge number, it's only 100 a year, 6 months, but it's just started. And I hope that this will help the sort of grassroots exchanges between Japan and the United States. Thank you very much.
Yes.
Ambassador, thank you very much for a very enlightening and global presentation. My name is Gerrit van der Wies. I'm from the Netherlands, one of your Benelux countries. But my question is about another small country, Taiwan.
It was good that you're not from Luxembourg.
he walked out.
Luxembourg has very good wine. I can really recommend it. One topic that you did not really touch on very much in your presentation is democracy and freedom in East Asia. Taiwan, of course, went through its transition to democracy only 20 years ago and is very young democracy. And my question is, how can Japan strengthen its ties with Taiwan in order to strengthen democracy and freedom in East Asia?
As you know very well, I think, having asked that question, as for political relations, we have decided to concentrate that with the Republic of China. As for trade, we have with Taiwan, but we would not have a political security relations with Taiwan. As for your question of developing democracy or human rights, as you have rightly said, that country, that area of Taiwan has become a very developed a democratic area, and I think it's not for Japan to come out and tell them or instigate their move. I think they are on their right path. Thank you very much.
Jack.
Jack Pritchard. Ambassador, I'm struck by your Chinese three nils, although they're Japanese from your point of view. They suggest that you have a concern, or at least a building concern, about the current U.S.-Japan relationship. When you talk about a relationship should not have surprises, not be over-politicized, and not take each other for granted. Are there things that you look at as you're departing your post that you might recommend to improve this wonderful relationship?
When I thank you very much for taking up that, because when I thought of these three no's, some of my colleagues said it may sound a little too negative, so don't say it. That was several years ago. I didn't take that advice, because overall U.S.-Japan's relations are very sound. 80% of 82% of Japanese say they like United States Americans. 84% of Americans say they trust Japanese. So people-to-people relations are very good, and we have very strong economic ties. Now, government's role is to try to enhance that, not to try to endanger that. We have to be very careful always in managing that. And just to say that the relations have never been better or something is not, I think, what we should be doing. I think we should be always caring as a government official, try to inform each other very well, try to solve issues as discreetly as possible, of course transparent, and try always to think what they are doing for us. And that kind of manner, I think, has to be always kept. But it doesn't mean that it is negative or it is we are concerned. But I think these have to be kept. I think in future, in order to improve, I think young people's exchanges have to be enhanced. Now we are inviting, after earthquake, tsunami, 1,000 high school kids from United States to Japan, 1,000 from Japan, affected area to United States, and from Japan to United States, and they are here now. But I think these have to be continued, expanded, as well as this teachers program, as I have said. Of course, we need to, and scholarships as well, we need to constantly help those, I think, is needed, and I think that's the responsibility of senior people or government officials, and I hope that those will be done. Thank you very much for asking the right question.
Hugh Grindstaff, this is a soft question. What are you going to tell your predecessor was the best part of your tenure in Washington, and what are you going to suggest to him to enjoy himself with?
Successor, you mean, right?
Yeah.
Yes. I am sorry to him that he could not enjoy what I have enjoyed, because I was here 100 years of cherry blossoms. That centennial was something very special. I don't think 101 year or 102 year will be, we'll try to make it, I'm sure, but we'll not be exactly the same. So that great moment, I think, I cannot share. But everyone has different chances. For example, my predecessor was a baseball maniac, you may know, Kato. And he was able to recite in 1967, his average was 374 or something like that, everything. And he enjoyed the baseball here, Major League Baseball, and he made a lot of friends through that. And then even after retirement, he's the baseball commissioner of Japan. So everyone has different character, and I enjoyed a lot of things here and meeting people, making friends. I toured around the country. I think my colleague counted, and I think as ambassador I went to 47 or something like that. But when I was political minister, I went to some of the states, and when I was in university here, I went. So I think I've been done to all 50. And I traveled and spoke and met people, and that was what I really enjoyed. But the people have different touches, I think.
I was at the.
And I really enjoyed being at CSI speaking as well. sorry.
Does that mean I don't have to ask the question, what's the best think tank in Washington now? I was at the Smithsonian this weekend, Ambassador, and there's still in all the gift shops a large section selling different clothing and pins and things from the Cherry Blossom Festival.
Is it 50% reduction?
Or? No. Quite the opposite. They told us that it's so popular, it's now a permanent part of all the stores. So it will last. It won't be as big as 100 years, but it will be very much part of every
Washington
experience.
Maybe I'll go and buy something for a souvenir to Japan. Then.
Maybe you get a 50% discount. You enjoyed the Cherry Blossom Festival. You also enjoyed the transition to the Democratic Party of Japan. I wanted to ask you, since you got an easy question, we're now 3 years plus a few months into the Democratic Party of Japan. It was a big, big transition in the U.S.-Japan alliance, and to your credit, we came out of it stronger, I think. But I wonder what lessons you have about how to handle these political transitions. We may have another in Japan soon. We just had an election, and although the presidency and the Congress stay the same, we have so many Asia experts retiring in the Senate, Lieberman, Webb, and so Lugar. So there's going to be a lot of change in U.S. and Japanese domestic politics, and your three no's is a good start. I wonder what other thoughts you have about how to manage a strong alliance at a time when there is political change in both countries.
Very frankly, I'll be very frank with you. When the new party came into administration in Japan, they had been in the opposition for so long, so they thought they would not use the bureaucracy or civil servant, and they would decide by themselves. This was the thinking in the initial stage. So, however, soon they thought that now it would be better to sort of utilize all the knowledge or information or experiences gathered over years. So now we don't see the trace of what they have tried to sort of exclude civil servants and things like that, which were there in the beginning. But so I think that kind of experience was one of those experiences that we had to go through. I think as for relations like Japan, U.S., no matter what government comes in, they understand very soon that this is the cornerstone key of Japan's diplomacy. And that means that both sides, as I said, have to do the effort, not take for granted, not just saying that we are doing this. So this kind of, I think, understanding has been developed very quickly, and I don't think there's now an issue there.
Good. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Ambassador. My name is Takao from NHK Japan Broadcasting Corporation. I have a question. This early morning, President Obama is re-elected, and you served as the ambassador the full of his first term. And what do you expect the second term, of his second term, and what do you expect, what kind of, you know, relation do you expect in his next term, and what can you, what kind of advice are you going to make to the, you know, next ambassador? And also, I'm interested in the, what is the, you know, most difficult time in your tenure? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. As for the last part, S3-11 was the most difficult experience. Some people ask me that, did I work for US-Japan, fortifying US-Japan relations through that incident? I said no. That was really a national crisis in Japan. And I was working here in order to get as much support from the United States. And of course, the main channel was in Tokyo, but we were able to work 16 hours here, and we were able to work 16 hours there. We were able to snatch 32 hours out of day, and we really worked so closely because U.S. Government has made a team of 24/7 staying in, for example, in Energy Department, State Department, all night, coping with the issue. They really treat it as their own issue. So. But we were able to come around, I said, but this was the most difficult time. Of course, very frankly, in the beginning, not all the information passing was so smooth, and but that lasted only a few days, but still, we were concerned how it would go. Second, as for the advice, I think my successor, who I had worked with, knows very well, so I don't need any, he doesn't need any advice from me. But this town is a big town and small town. Everyone knows each other, and so it's not only government, but you have Congress, you have society, you have museums, whatever, all the things, and people know each other very, very well in this society. So you have to be go into that group of people, and I think I really enjoyed it. I'm sure that he'll enjoy it too. As for the next administration, I think the President Obama said, his policy of putting emphasis on Asia Pacific. I think will continue because he has started that from the beginning of his term, joining EAS, ASEAN ambassador, Secretary Clinton was the first one to come to Japan. She chose Japan as the first visit. President Obama invited Japanese Prime Minister as his first guest, and that kind of relations with Japan and Asia Pacific, I think, has been constantly there, so I hope that they will, it'll continue, and I'm convinced that. Now, however, of course, in second administrations, it's not only United States who decides. There are international environment that may require them to come up with policies, North Korea, Iran, Middle East. So what's important is that Japan and U.S. always keep in touch, always consult, as I say, no surprise. Thank you very much.
Well, Ambassador, we thank you for joining us today and for answering a range of questions. Also, I think all of us should thank you for your service. This has been an incredibly consequential time you've spent here with huge challenges like 3/11 or political transformations, elections in both countries. The alliance is stronger, the people-to-people relations are stronger, much of it is to your credit. And we thank you. The Navy has acknowledged your service. I think we can acknowledge your service in a small way with a very warm applause. It's to thank you for joining us.
Am I graduating?
Did you graduate? Yes.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mike. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.